Hello and welcome to worship on this first Sunday in Lent. If we were in church today, we'd be starting to build our Lent cross when we put items on the cross that relate to Jesus' journey towards Good Friday and the glorious resurrection of Easter Day. Unfortunately, we're not able to be in our church buildings at the moment, so I'm encouraging you to build your own Lent cross and your own worship space in your own home. In the post this week or by email, you'll have received a cross designed by Steph from the Triangle. I encourage you to find a space in your home to place it for the next 6 weeks. And each week as we build our theme through Lent, I invite you to add something of significance to you around the theme of the service and place it around the cross. Today's theme is temptation and testing. What tempts you? What is your downfall that you find hard to resist? As Jesus was tempted in the wilderness by Satan, what may be the thing that you find hard to turn your back on? For me, I'm putting down a piece of cake. For you, it might be a bar of chocolate, an alcoholic drink perhaps, or your phone that takes you away from your loved ones. What are you placing around the cross today? Matthew 4 verse 1 says, "Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you knew the full force of temptation, yet you conquered it in the fight against Satan. Breathe into my life the strength of your Holy Spirit, that I too, in every moment of testing, may stand fast as you did. In the challenge to combat temptation in my life, may I never grow faint or weary, but rather persevere to the end, until I hear you say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Amen.
For our prayers this morning, there is a response. So when I say the words, "Create in us a clean heart, O Lord," please respond, "And put a right spirit within us." Create in us a clean heart, O Lord, and put a right spirit within us. So let's pray. Gracious and merciful God, on this first Sunday of Lent, we come together to worship you, to praise and thank you, to seek your forgiveness and to ask for renewal. Create in us a clean heart, O Lord, and put a right spirit within us. We come in the name of Christ, remembering his lonely days in the wilderness, his time wrestling with temptation, and the ministry that followed, restoring and transforming so many lives. Create in us a clean heart, O Lord, and put a right spirit within us. Help us to learn from his example, to search our hearts as he did, to consider our calling, to reflect on our faith, to resist temptation, and to commit ourselves more wholly to you. Create in us a clean heart, O Lord, and put a right spirit within us. Help us to recognise all Jesus has done for us through his life, death and resurrection, and so may we come gladly to you, confessing our sins, acknowledging our faults, accepting our weaknesses, and receiving your forgiveness. Create in us a clean heart, O Lord, and put a right spirit within us. Gracious and merciful God, we come to you on this first Sunday of Lent. Speak to us today and in the days ahead, so that we may know you and love you better. Create in us a clean heart, O Lord, and put a right spirit within us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The reading is from Psalm 25, verses 1 to 10. In you, Lord my God, I put my trust. I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame, but shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are my saviour, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them his way. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful towards those who keep the demands of his covenant. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord.
Gospel reading is Mark chapter 1 verses 9 to 15. At that time Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news."
30 years, Jesus had lived at the heart of a loving family in the small town of Nazareth in Galilee. He had learnt the craft of carpentry at the side of Joseph, the man who everyone would assume was his father. He'd been the older brother of several younger siblings. Then the rumours start to spread of a man who has come from the desert and called people to turn their lives around, to turn back to God. He is a man who isn't afraid to call out the religious authorities for their treatment of the people and their own lack of faith. And Jesus must begin to wonder at this moment if it is time for him to step out of obscurity and into the public gaze. So he travels to the Jordan, where this man John is baptizing the people. He joins the queue, and like those before him and behind him, he steps into the water to be baptized. John must seem confused and reluctant. He instantly knows that Jesus does not need to be baptized, because baptism is a sign of repentance and washing away of sins. And he knows that Jesus is without sin and has no need of repentance. But Jesus insists, for this is his way of being identified along with the people around him, the people he had come to offer salvation. And as Jesus rises out of the water of the Jordan, he hears the most beautiful words. God, his Father, is speaking to him. You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased. During the ups and downs of ministry and the difficult road ahead that would lead to a cross of pain and suffering, those words of blessing must have remained in his heart and mind, and the knowledge of that love would sustain him during that journey. This was a moment of identity for Jesus. I know that I am God's child and I am well loved. I hope that you too can say, I know that I am God's child and I am well loved. It's the reassurance that we all need. Almost immediately, the same Spirit who rested on him at his baptism forces him into the wilderness for 40 days, where his companions are Satan, wild animals, angels, and God. The time of preparation for earthly ministry has begun. Most of what we know about Jesus' time in the wilderness is provided by Matthew and Luke, because Mark is very curt almost in his telling of the events, and John doesn't mention it at all. In two very short verses, Mark tells us this. The Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness for 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. The Spirit forced, thrust, drove, and pushed Jesus. The words are almost violent in their descriptions of what the Spirit did, and they most certainly seem at odds with what we would have expected of the Spirit. It's not what we would expect from him. Give me comfort and a helper over one who drives and forces. But before Jesus can begin his ministry, the time of testing and temptation must take place. For 40 days, almost 6 weeks, Jesus is in the wilderness, an inhospitable place, somewhere to be avoided, dangerous and lonely. A place where Jesus would be completely alone and isolated and have no one to rely on except for God. It has the echoes of another journey in a wilderness that didn't take 40 days, but 40 years, where the Israelites wandered after fleeing captivity in Egypt. They too had to learn to rely on God, but countless times they couldn't do that, and their wandering continued. And so Jesus faces a time of testing, and the audible approval of God is replaced by the assault of Satan. as metal is put under enormous pressure to test its strength before being used for something important. So those who God intends to use must be tested too. I really don't believe that when difficult times comes in our life, that this is God testing to see how we will cope, and if we don't, then we'll fail the test. Please never ever say of something that you're struggling to cope with, "Why is God testing me with this?" Because that is not the action of a loving father to a well-loved child. But every one of us who decides to live for God and to live for others will be tested. When we have made that decision to be a follower of Jesus, then the adversary of Jesus becomes our adversary too. At times, the temptations in life can become huge, but God may allow those in order to help us to rely on Him more, to lean on Him, and to trust Him rather than anything else. The beautiful words of Michelle Coist in a powerful prayer about temptation say this:
"I am at the end of my tether, Lord. I am shattered. I am broken. Since this morning I have been struggling to escape temptation, which now subtle, now persuasive, now tender, now sensuous, dances before me like a glamour girl at a fair. I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. It spies on me, follows me, engulfs me. When I leave a room, I find it seated and waiting for me in the next."
To anyone who suffers with addiction or finds it very hard to resist temptation, those words may speak to you as much as they speak to me. Ever notice that when you've had a time in your life that you've felt very close to God, that surely afterwards you may feel down in the deepest valley? For the adversary of Jesus is our adversary too. The temptations by Satan were a moment of decision for Jesus. He knew he had an enormous task ahead of him, and he knew he had enormous power with which to do it. Would he choose God's way of suffering and love and reaching out to people through his sacrifice? Or would he choose the way of Satan, his adversary, who put the idea in his mind, "You can use your power to win over these people. You don't have to go to all that trouble of pain and suffering." Which one would Jesus choose? Alone in the wilderness, he chose to take the God-given road, the hard road, the road to crucifixion. But he was not alone. And when we're on the hard road, we're not alone either. Have you ever noticed that Mark says that Jesus was with wild animals and that angels waited on him? I confess I'd not. With Matthew and Luke, we have all the meat of the temptations and what they involved. So perhaps we fail to notice those little details about animals and angels. Mark doesn't tell us if those animals were threatening or friendly. Perhaps they are mentioned to show Jesus' vulnerability and dependence on God. Nor does he tell us very much about the angels. They were not there to keep Jesus from being tested, but they wouldn't keep him from going to Calvary either. I believe that they were there to offer reassurance and to remind him during those difficult days that he was a beloved child of God, that his Father was watching over him, loving him, acting in his life, pouring out the Spirit upon him. Angels watching over him. What a wonderful phrase. Jesus shortly was to leave that place and go to where the people were. He was to go with words of love and words of life. In the meantime, angels watched over him with love. Perhaps that knowledge of angels with Jesus is helpful for you too today. Today is the first Sunday of Lent. Lent challenges us to remove some of our safety nets and identify with Jesus as we travel through the next 40 days or 6 weeks. Most of us do that in small ways as we give something up, sweets or cakes or alcohol perhaps. And again, we too, like those Israelites, may fail. Perhaps this Lent, we could take the opportunity instead or as well to refocus. To focus on Jesus as he travelled towards the cross. It could be for us a journey of new discoveries or rediscoveries. As we think of those words of God to Jesus at his baptism, and what hearing those words might mean for you and for me. I am a child of God. He loves me. He is well pleased with me. You are a child of God. He loves you and he is pleased with you. It might be an opportunity to reflect back on testing times and reigniting a greater reliance and trust in God. It might be the knowledge of angels watching over Jesus and the possibility of angels watching over us too. May God bless you. Amen. An agape meal, or a love feast, is a Christian fellowship meal, recalling the meals that Jesus shared with his disciples during his ministry and expressing the community and fellowship enjoyed by the family of Christ. It's not the same as Holy Communion or the Lord's Supper. Instead, the love feast has often been held on occasions when it's not practical to have a Holy Communion. At a traditional love feast, a two-handled cup would be used like this, rather like the one that I remember from my childhood. The love feast came into existence in the early 1700s. Wesley had seen it as part of his work with the Moravian Church, and it was something that really touched him. It became very much part of early Methodism and the evangelical revival. And while they became less frequent over the years, they are something that today is being revived in all sorts of different places. It's usually held around a table with everyone seated in a circle. The focal points are prayer and testimony of what God is doing in the lives of people. And at the very centre of it is sharing food together. It is customary not for this to be the bread that we may use at communion, but crackers or sweet bread and water, or to have cake and coffee and tea, whatever your choice and your conscience. So invite you, as we share in this love feast together, to say along with me the words in bold. Out of the darkness came light, and the power of God was revealed in the running wave and the flowing air, in the quiet earth and the shining stars. Out of the dust came life, and the image of God was revealed in the human face and the gentle heart, in the warmth of flesh and the depth of soul. Out of justice came freedom, and the wisdom of God was revealed in the need to grow and the will to love, in the chance to know and the power to choose. And God looked at the creation, and behold, it was very good. Psalm 34 verse 1 says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. We say together, I will keep on thanking God with constant words of prayer. I will glory in the living God. The humble will hear and be glad. Living God, our loving parent, you cherish your creation and we praise you. With earth, air, wind, fire, in our element as your children, we praise you. With our lips, with our lives, in all our diversity, with each made in your image, we praise you. Because in Jesus, you came to share our human lives, our sorrow and joy, we praise you. Because your Spirit is at work today, encouraging, enabling, surprising us, we praise you. Poor as we are, you give us hope. Salt of the earth, you give us meaning and purpose, and we praise you. Amen. And reading from Mark chapter 9 verse 50. Salt is good, but if salt loses its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Giving God, you blessed us with saltiness, but we became bland. You trusted us with your word, but we did not keep it. You lit a flame in our midst, but we hid it under formality, smothered it with our fears. God, in your mercy, forgive us. Forgiving God, we believe that you have called us to be salt and light, that you offer us time and space and strength to begin again. Giving and forgiving God, we thank you. Have salt in yourself and be at peace with one another. Amen. Psalm 34 verse 8. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. We are all invited to the common table to share in an agape feast. At this table, we come as brothers and sisters in the holy family of God. Taste and see that God is good. If we were gathered together, the feast would be a loaf of bread, oat cakes, or a sweet bread, and a jug of wine, water, or grape juice. The bread and the wine would be passed to one another, each person serving the person next to them. At this point, we would eat together as people share what God is doing in their lives. so as Arnold and Janet share with us, I invite you to eat and drink.
Good morning. Where do I see God working in my life currently? That is a very good rhetorical question. But to me, as a follower of Christ, it is an opportunity to share my faith and testify of the goodness of the Lord. I am always thankful to God for the gift of life, and especially in these scary and challenging times, every day I wake up being counted in the land of the living is a present, a blessing. I have learned to always count my blessings and name them one by one. And that helps me in those moments when I feel as if things are not going well for me. I am always reminded by the faith I have that I have received more blessings than what I may perceive to be troubles. Just like most other people, the COVID-19 pandemic has also had an impact on me. I have friends and family who have also been afflicted, and some even succumbed to this virus. But in all this, for me, I believe the grace and presence of God has and continues to protect me. I have gone to supermarkets, I've gone for hospital appointments, to the post office, done the school run, and etc. Yes, I may have a mask on, but really, is it the mask or PPE that protects me, or it is God? So for me, therein lies the response to where God is working in my life. Amen.
So where do I see God in the world at the moment? I see God in the beauty of nature, whether that's a snowdrop in the garden, a bright sunny morning after a run of dark, dreary grey mornings. Last Sunday, I saw the heron as I walked along the Middlebrook, looking so majestic. I also see God in the power of nature. Last week, I went to pick my dad up to take him to a hospital appointment, and I park in a supermarket car park by his flat. And it was just incredible to believe that just a week before, that car park had been completely submerged in water, so much so that you could only see the curved tops of the trolley parks. But here it was a week later, looking so different. Just a reminder of the real power of God and nature. I was taking Dad to have his heart pacemaker checked. He nearly died 8 years ago of heart failure, so this machine is keeping him alive. And it's a real reminder of the intricacies of the human body and the advances in modern medicine, and shows the wisdom and creativity of our God. I also see God in the words of encouragement from other people, and even in the smile of a stranger on my daily walk. I think people sharing their own faith and their own testimonies. Again, I see God talking through these people and encouraging us all. And last week, my friend's daughter shared her experience of getting married in COVID on Songs of Praise. And I think it's a real encouragement to us all to hear these stories. I see God speaking through her. And then finally, I see God at work in COVID. I think he's trying to tell us all that we all need to slow down. He's showing us how important family and friends are to us, how much we need social connection. And I think finally, he's showing us that however much we plan ahead and we try and take control and control what happens to us, we can't, and we need to rely on him.
Let us pray. As we have shared in food, as we have poured out water, we thank you, God, for our daily bread, for the food which delights and nourishes us, and for the companionship that sustains us. We thank you too for water to drink that quenches our thirst, and living water with which you surprise, enrich and transform our lives. We give thanks for this feast, which we share a foretaste of the heavenly realm. Amen. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Giving God, bless all who have gathered around a table, and every person taking part this day. May we know the fullness of your presence at every meal and in all our sharing. Amen.
We come now to our prayers for others, and there is a response. When I say, gracious Lord, could you respond with, help us to say no. Gracious Lord, help us to say no. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you that you held firm to your faith no matter the pressure. That, despite the temptation to take an easier, less costly way, you refuse to compromise your convictions. When we are tempted in turn, gracious Lord, help us to say no. When we are tempted to follow the crowd, to shirk difficult decisions, to water down our principles and pander to popular opinion, gracious Lord, help us to say no. When we are tempted to put ourselves first, to trust in our strength, to seek our own ends and to follow our own inclinations, gracious Lord, help us to say no. When we are tempted to forget others, neglectful of their needs, dismissive of their opinions, unconcerned as to their welfare, gracious Lord, help us to say no. When we are tempted to go astray, to indulge our desires, ignore your will, excuse what we know is inexcusable, gracious Lord, help us to say no. Lord Jesus Christ, you were tempted just as we are, and yet you stood firm, even though the way you had chosen took you to death on a cross. Touch our lives and grant us your faith, strength, vision and courage, so that in a time of trial we too may stay true to your way. When we are tempted in turn, gracious Lord, help us to say no. For your name's sake, amen.
I watch the sunrise lighting the sky, following all my ways.
Whatever wilderness the Spirit has brought you to, walk in boldness as a beloved child of God. Walk in peace under the shelter of the Most High. Walk in faith, knowing Christ walks beside you. Amen.